G'day everybody, it's great to be with you. Today I'm standing at the bottom of the clock tower. Above me is where the clock is, and above that is where the bells are. Even though St John's was built in 1849, the bells and the clock weren't used until about 1897, when they were commissioned by Mrs. MacArthur Onslow. You'll know that the clock and the bells work together, and so they play at various time intervals. We have a peal of bells, 8 bells all in all, and not many churches have that. It is pretty significant. And if you can imagine a keyboard, has an octave, a piano has an octave, then we have all those notes except the black notes. The biggest bell is this one, and it weighs 710 kilos. And the incredible thing about that bell, you may not know, but engraved on that bell is the words of the doxology. It's a hymn that we sing. Praise God in whom all blessings flow. And it goes, the whole verse is written, and it finishes off with praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Folks, that's what we're going to do today. We're going to praise God for his goodness.
Hello, family of God. I hope you're in the mood to rejoice with us and praise our great God. So let's sing. Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to him. With steady arms of mercy's reach to gather children.
Just a couple of announcements. Our AGM is happening on the 20th of September, Sunday the 20th of September at 2 p.m. And the other thing I want to mention to people, that we're starting something a little bit different next Sunday. There goes the bells. next Sunday, we're starting a thing that I'm calling the foyer. And what we're trying to do is to encourage everybody to connect in, come in, on Zoom, just so that for 15 minutes, just so that the staff can say hello to you. You might be able to see some faces that you remember. It'll just be a good time to come together. So next Sunday, 9:45, only for 15 minutes, come on and Zoom. I'll send you the online link.
Well, greetings, everyone. Don't be alarmed. You don't need to adjust your TV screens. I'm just here to sort of share what strength in the house means to me and some thoughts I had from Tony's sermon that he wanted me to sort of talk about briefly. And so it's been interesting to think about strength in the house. Like, well, what does that mean to me? So at St. John's, I think there's been a really rich history of the church family strengthening one another in various ways. In some ways, I've seen what true Christianity is, and I think that's when we see faith in action. Take, for example, Winter Beach Camp. I know I talk about it a lot and often, but I thought I'd share something a little bit different than usual today. I brought some props with me today, and I thought that might be helpful to sort of give us that helpful illustration. You see, Winter Beach Camp isn't just something I've done as a leader. I've also done it as a young teenager. This was my Winter Beach Camp hoodie from 2006. I had to contact the previous youth minister, Paul Gaitchens, to find out when this beach camp hoodie was. So there's that one. We've got another relic or artifact from the Winter Beach Camp archives. This is a Winter Beach Camp shirt from 2007. Can you believe that I once fit into a shirt like this? Neither can I. But why have I held on to these old clothes? Why didn't I throw them out, I don't know, 10 years ago? Well, I hold on to them because, you know, they're a wonderful reminder of the church family strengthening me in my faith when I was young and new to Christianity. And being a young teenager, if you didn't know much, I really needed guidance. But if you think about it, Winter Beach Camp existed in the first place because, you know, there was a youth minister. For those who may know or remember, Paul Gaitchens. And he desired to put a camp on. And I suppose even before he did the camp, before the youth minister came, the church was able to raise funds to hire a youth minister to start a camp called Winter Beach Camp, in which I attended. And the result of this is, well, it strengthened my faith and continue to be strengthened by the church family in general. You know, another great memory of Winter Beach Camp I have is that every time we've called for the church family to donate, sponsor, or strengthen, I've never been disappointed. There's always been people willing to put up their hand and generously give. I'm very thankful for these people, and you know who you are. But you know what? Let's keep the momentum of generosity going. Let's keep the culture of strengthening the house alive. You know, we can only strengthen the house if the people of the house of God are prepared to do so. I encourage you to pray about what you want to give and to be open to what God wants you to do. And look, yes, you know, Winter Beach Camp hasn't been on this year and it won't be on, sadly. But, you know, next year you can count on it being on if everything's going ahead as smooth as possible. But you know what? There's lots of other ways that you could be supporting the church family. It's not just limited to Winter Beach Camp. You know, I understand that doing things like this to give and to give up things, it can be hard to be generous sometimes. Yes, it does take a sacrifice. Sometimes we have to go outside our comfort zone. However, God has revealed countless times throughout the Bible and history that when we are faithful to God, He'll be faithful to us. And so when we put our faith into action, like Tony kind of talked about, it's never wasted. You know, just imagine for a moment, like if back in the early 2000s that people weren't generous, people didn't strengthen the house, you know, there'd be no youth minister, there'd be no Winter Beach Camp. Therefore, I and many other people that have been strengthened by the church wouldn't be here today. Your impact to strengthen the house goes above and beyond our wildest dreams when we trust God and we be generous.
Thanks, James. Today's verse of the day comes from James chapter 2, verse 17. We all know it really well. Let's say it together. Faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. Friends, now let's worship our God in the words of Psalm 95. Let's together. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. How fantastic it is that the Lord our God we worship this morning. And friends, as we said earlier in our verse of the day, that faith not accompanied by action is dead, and we look at our lives, sometimes we don't do what we say we're going to do, and we don't live the way we say. Let's spend a moment to think about the times when we don't do that, and then together we'll confess our sins. Together. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are proved right when you speak, and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Now our friend Sandra will continue to lead us in prayer.
Hello everyone. Let us pray. Dear Father, we come before you to give you great thanks that we are your children. Help us to live Christian lives. Help us to grow in our relationship with you. Soften our hearts towards those you ask us to forgive, as you have done for us. Father, we pray that our lives will be encouragement to others in word and deed. We thank you for the leadership of Tony and Debbie, Irfan and Barbara, for the focus on the Bible and how to understand it and apply it in our lives. We pray for their good health and protection from the evil one, also for wisdom and energy how they serve us. Father, we thank you for our dedicated pastoral team of Debbie, Pat, Trish, Jan, David, and Tilda, and Sarah. Keep them all healthy as they continue with their duties through all this upheaval that has been happening during the last 6 months. We pray for Jimmy and Haley as they lead our youth group. We thank them for their expertise with technology that enables our church services to be streamed into our homes everywhere. We are blessed with our young people and the pleasure we have in watching them grow in their faith. Father, we pray for our missionaries here and overseas. Keep them safe and protected. We pray, Lord, that our scripture classes will continue in our schools. Children need to know of your love and compassion, especially now in these worrying times, that they can put their trust in you. Father, our prayers are with our fellow countrymen in Victoria. We are shocked and saddened by the loss of life and the continuing cases of COVID that keep rising. We pray for a vaccine that it will come soon. Lord, we also praise for the tragedy in Lebanon. They are not only coping with this pandemic, but also with the terrible disaster. Our prayers are with them. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Let the presence of the risen Lord come renew my heart and make me whole. Cause your word to come alive.
The reading this morning is from James, chapter 2. My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy old clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, "Here's a good seat for you," but say to the poor man, "You stand there or sit on the floor by my feet," have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers and sisters, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes at the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? And are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are blaspheming the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not commit murder." If you do not commit adultery, but to commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom. Because judgment without mercy will show to anyone who has not been merciful, mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but have no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm and well fed," but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, "You have faith, I have deeds." Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Was not one of our father Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, "Abraham believed God, and was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend." You see, that person is considered righteous by what they do, and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab, the prostitute, considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in different directions? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
You know, one of the most hurtful ways to break down relationships is through favoritism. When people are biased, when people are partial, when people are prejudiced, people show favoritism and it hurts. In families, favoritism can cause fights and quarrels, especially when it comes to the will. In school, if a teacher has a favourite, a pet, then no doubt bullying will happen from others. Even in the Old Testament law, Israel is warned not to show favourites, that they needed to judge carefully. Today, our Black Lives Matter movement I may not agree how they protest, but the equality of the first people is to be upheld. And the reason why we have this situation in our society is because over hundreds of years, white people have been favoured. But with God, there's no partiality, bribes, injustice, or favouritism. God hates favouritism. And so should we in the church. Church that is partial to certain people has problems. Church should destroy favouritism, otherwise favouritism will actually destroy the church. Many years ago, when I was at Beverly Hills Church, at our night service, we had one person had a mental disability, and they would yawn and interrupt sometimes during the service. They would cause a little bit of problems, but everybody loved this particular person. Some of the young people, I remember, came to me and they said, look, we're a little bit embarrassed. We don't want to invite our friends because of this particular person. And, you know, I thought about it and I thought, no, we can't do that. That person needs to stay in our congregation because we do not have any favourites. You know, when I first came to Camden, it had a reputation of having certain cliques. And I remember one of the associate ministers who was trying to describe a group of people, and he said, you know, the beautiful people. And it was incredible that the whole staff knew what that person was talking about. It was a little group of people that excluded others. Favoritism is possibly found in all churches, but it is detestable to God. It doesn't show genuine faith. In James chapter 2, James wants to show faith without actions is dead. And he repeats it time and time again. The issue is not, can faith save us? The issue is, faith without actions cannot save us. James wants us to have a genuine faith, not a veneer faith, not a nominal faith, not a pretend faith, but a genuine faith, a faith that is checkable through our actions. So James gives us this checklist of what a genuine faith is not and what it is. Firstly, he says, a genuine faith is not discriminatory. In the very first verse of chapter 2, he says, my brothers and sisters, believers in the glorious Lord Jesus Christ must not show favoritism. And so firstly, we shouldn't show favoritism because we are God's church. We are his family. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. We have a common faith in Jesus. And if Jesus is our brother, we are equal in Christ. The logic is clear. If God's church is the family of God, then we are united. There should be no favoritism. No favoritism should take place. And James gives us an example of a well-dressed man, and he gets the best seat in the church. And he says, no, that shouldn't be the case. I know you and I may not do that. But sometimes we can show special attention to people who maybe drive the best cars, have the expensive jewellery, wear the trendy clothes, who are good looking, people who are cool. You know, we can make judgments from external appearances. And James says, you know, we become judges of others. When we show favouritism, we become judgmental. The second reason why we shouldn't show favouritism is because we are God's elect, and he mentions that in verse 5. God chose Israel to be the people of God, to do the work of evangelism for God. Now, I know it sounds like God is showing favoritism himself, but his election is loving and it's purposeful. The election of God reverses the values of the world because God chooses the poor and the humble in spirit in order to become rich in faith. Friends, brains, brawn and bucks have advantages in this judgmental world, but wealth and fame and power and all that type of stuff have no place with God. God humbles the proud and exalts the humble. The third reason why we shouldn't show favoritism is because of God's law of love. And love is the essence of God. It's the royal law, the kingly law of God, to love each other. Love never excludes our brothers or sisters. And to show favoritism means we become lawbreakers. Favoritism is the opposite to what God is about. God is about the inclusion of the family of God. And the fourth reason why we shouldn't show favoritism is because of God's judgment. Friends, when we show favoritism, we are not being merciful to each other. And James says, judgment without mercy will be given to those who show no mercy. And friends, at the cross of Jesus, we see judgment and mercy. At the cross of Jesus, Jesus takes our judgment because of our sin through his own death. Mercy is satisfied for all people of faith, whether they are Jew or Gentile, whether they are black or white, whether they are male or female, and so on. Evaluating people according to externals undermines the family of God. If God is merciful, so should we be. Favoritism contradicts the gospel because the gospel levels us out. We are of equal dignity and value. And our feelings towards people we like should never, never ostracize others. One of my favorite passages in Acts chapter 2, we have the picture of the early church. And they were together. That word together comes up a number of times. They read the Bible together. They prayed together. They heard the word of God together. They had fellowship together. They helped each other together. And then there's a beautiful verse in verse 47 of chapter 2. And the Lord added to their number daily. A great example of when the Christian church is loving each other together, the Lord will bless the church with more converts. The reason why churches don't impact the community today is because they are not always loving to each other or equally. Christianity is accepting and loving all. I guess the question that rises from all this, should I ever associate with people I like? Of course you can. But we must be careful that in our love for people that we like, we are not sending out the message of exclusion to others. And if you have somebody over for tea that is with the same social status, that's fine. That has the same interests of you, that's good. But also have people over who may not be the same as you, who might be disadvantaged, who may be less attractive in your eyes. The second thing that James says, genuine faith is not dead. In our verse of the day, verse 17, he says, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, is dead. Genuine faith will be generous of our time, our money, our energy. We won't fob off the needy. What do we do when we come across someone that's struggling, maybe mentally, physically? You know, I've done it. Sometimes I've just said, I'll pray for you. Friends, can I say, if that's all we do, it's the ultimate hypocrisy. It's no good to the needy. It can be a cop-out not to involve ourselves. The fact that we have an opportunity to do something is God's way, is giving us that opportunity to help. Faith with all words and no action is deceptive. It's dead. Thirdly, genuine faith is not just about data, or it's not just about knowledge. We have that incredible verse in verse 19. You believe there is one God? Good, James says. Even the demons believe that. And genuine faith is more than just knowledge about God, folks. Jesus says the same thing in the gospel. He says, even the devil believes that he is the Son of God. He is the Holy One of God. He is the Christ. He is the One. Folks, can I say there are people in hell with good, sound doctrine? There are people in hell that know their Bible well, but that won't keep them out of hell. Faith that is all talk, all knowledge, is deceptive. In fact, James wants to say it's nearly demonic. Wisdom is putting that knowledge into action. So it's not discriminatory, it's not dead, and it's not just about data. What is genuine faith? Well, folks, it's a dynamic faith. In verse 20, James says, "You foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless?" 6 times in this chapter, James says, faith without deeds is dead. You see, a genuine faith, a dynamic faith, will always result in action and a changed life. Can I ask you the question? How much have you grown over the last 12 months? Have you changed to be more like Jesus? Are you busy for Jesus? Discriminatory faith involves our emotions and feelings, and that will just lead to favoritism. A dead faith involves our pious words without any loving actions. And a data-based faith involves just knowledge and then the intellect, and the demons love it. Friends, real faith is not what we feel. It's not what we say. It's not what we think. James is saying it's what we do. And I think we see in Hebrews chapter 11 the same idea. We see the heroes of faith in the Old Testament, and they are all described by what they did. James gives us two illustrations, two different types of people, different backgrounds that had a dynamic faith. Firstly, Abraham. Abraham was a Jew. He's the father of the faith. Early on, we are told that Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteous. Abraham was a man who was justified by faith. But his faith showed up in action, in his obedience, and when he was tested by God to sacrifice his own son Isaac. James gives us another illustration, Rahab. She was a Gentile, a prostitute. And her faith changed her life as she gave lodging to the Jewish spies. This could have led her to be executed as a traitor. You see, Abraham was willing to sacrifice his own son. Rahab was willing to sacrifice her own life. They were people of faith. We can talk the talk, but be short on sacrifice. Friends, a dynamic faith, a genuine faith, a real faith will involve sacrifice. But you know the incredible thing about that? It will always bring joy. It will always bring blessing and contentment to our souls. We need to ask ourselves, what sacrifices are we making for Jesus? Because it is an indication of a genuine, real, dynamic faith. At this point, I want to say, you're probably thinking, well, the Apostle Paul and James might seem contradictory, because one talks about we are justified by faith alone, and the other talks about we are justified by faith, which shows in our works. And I want to say they are saying the same thing, but they're writing to different audiences. Paul is opposing the DIY religion, if you want. And James opposes all talk and no action religion. Paul is talking to the Gentiles who thought they were being saved by their good works. And Paul says, no. The only way you are saved is through faith in Jesus, trusting in his death that you are forgiven, trusting in his resurrection that you can share eternal life. It's trusting the cross of Jesus. James is writing, on the other hand, to the Jews who had heard the gospel. And they thought, if I'm saved by faith, well, I don't need to do anything else. You know, they thought, you know, just live how I want to live and maybe ask for forgiveness later. I think Paul really sums it up in Ephesians 2 when he says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And then he talks about in Christ Jesus, we are created in Christ Jesus to do good works. This is what I think the Bible is saying. Our faith is not determined by what we do. It's demonstrated by what we do. Let me say that again. Our faith is not determined by what we do. It is demonstrated by what we do. In other words, our good works are not the root of our salvation, but they are the fruit of our salvation. Well, what are the demonstrations in your life that show that you have a dynamic faith? What fruit are you exhibiting? Folks, isn't it time for some of you to be fair dinkum about your faith? You know, some of you may have heard the story of Blondin, and he was a French-American trapeze artist in the late 1800s, and he told everyone that he was going to walk across Niagara Falls. So he strung a line, and that's what he was going to do. And everyone came to see this great feat. He strung this line, and there were reporters there, there were people there. And he had his big pole, and he walked across Niagara Falls and back again to the cheers of the crowd. The photographers were taking the photos. And then he got a wheelbarrow. And he walked across Niagara Falls and back again. And again, to the cheers of the crowd, people thought he was fantastic. And then he turned to one of the reporters and he said, "Do you believe that I can carry a man in this wheelbarrow across?" And the reporter, who thought Blondin was fantastic, said, "Yeah, Blondin, I think you can do it. You're fantastic. You're great." And Blondin said, "Good, jump in." And you know what the reporter said? "Not on your life." You know, he had a faith in his head, but it didn't show forth in his action. Friends, sometimes we need to take a leap of faith. Sometimes we need to sacrifice at the expense of our comforts. Jesus is saying, "Jump in the barrow, and I will take you to the place where you need to go." Friends, what better way to show our actions of love through this whole Strengthen the House? We have a great opportunity to get out of our comfort zone and sacrifice to the one who sacrificed his whole life for you and for me. Faith without actions, it's dead. Friends, can I encourage you, as I challenge myself, let's be alive in Christ. Let's have a dynamic faith as we seek to serve our Lord and Master. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do want to thank you for your goodness to us. Father, we want to thank you for the great examples of faith in Hebrews 11 and the whole Bible with Abraham and Rahab. Father, please help us to be a people of action, not just of words. Father, please, through your Spirit, move us to get us out of our comfort zone so that we might sacrifice and live the life you want us to live, because in the end, we know it is for our own good. And we do pray all these things for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Thank you, folks.
Thank you, Tony, for that really important message. Sometimes putting our faith into action can be hard, but the sacrifice we'll find is absolutely worth it. And friends, let's have that thought in our minds as we pray together the sending out prayer and move into the course of this week. Rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Thank you for joining us for online church, and we just pray that this has been a really important encouragement to you and all of your family and friends during the course of this week. Thanks.